In this video, I want to give you guys a little bit of feedback on your fabulous adapted children's stories illustrations. But this will also allow me to talk about some very interesting issues regarding digital painting. What I would like to do is introduce you to a couple of brushes that will simulate traditional media so that we can make some changes to our illustrations without it looking too obviously like a digital manipulation. And I'm going to do so using Alyssa's fabulous children's book illustration, East of the Sun, West of the Moon. This is a wonderful illustration. Remember when we first talked about doing this, I mentioned that there are three criteria that I really look for when discussing this project. A narrative illustration is really strong in these three areas. It has a strong setting. In this case, Alyssa has made the setting very much a feature. A narrative illustration also has a strong character. Again, Alyssa has made this a very strong feature. And finally, a narrative illustration has a strong and clear situation.
In terms of technique, Alyssa has done a classic mixed media, combining watercolor and pencil crayon. I find this a wonderful way of working. What we need to do is find some digital brushes that'll allow us to make some changes so that it feels like it was done traditionally. The first thing I'm going to do is make sure that I'm working with the correct type of brush. I've opened up my brush panel, and you can see that I have a number of brushes installed here that you may not have. While Photoshop has definitely improved its default brushes, I'm going to recommend that we download some brushes directly from the Adobe website. You'll notice that I have a folder here in my brushes panel called Megapack. And if I twirl that down, you'll see that I have a number of folders within that folder. You would quickly see that this Megapack lives up to its name. These are all the individual brushes in this drawing box folder. All these brushes have been created by a particular person. Kyle Webster has been making Photoshop brushes for years. It used to be just several years ago that you would have to buy them, but they were definitely worth the price, and I always recommended them to my students. But a couple of versions back, Photoshop recognized the value of having Kyle Webster's brushes built into the program and have made all of Kyle Webster's brushes available to you online. In fact, I have several of these Kyle Webster brushes installed here. This Megapack is one of them. If I scroll down a little bit further, though, you can see that I have something here called watercolor. This is another one of Kyle Webster brush collections. You can tell because they all have his name on them. All of these brushes are available to you to download here in the brushes panel. I'm going to click on the brushes panel options button right here, and from this menu I'm going to select Get More Brushes. And that is going to take us to a page, if I scroll down here, that has a number of interesting brushes that emulate traditional media very well. There are two that I'm going to recommend that you download, the Megapack and the Watercolor Set. When you click on any one of these, it's going to download what's called a .abr file, an Adobe brush file, as you can see here. What I need to do is put this watercolor.abr file into a particular folder. Let me show you where we're going to put this file. I'm going to just drag this Finder window over to the side, and I'm going to open up a new Finder window, and I'm going to navigate to my Applications folder, and I'm going to come to the Adobe Photoshop folder. I happen to be working with Adobe Photoshop 2020 at the moment, and I'm going to come to the Presets folder. Inside of that, you can see I have this folder called Brushes, and what I want to do is just drag this watercolor.abr file into this folder here. Once I have this file in my brushes folder, I now have access to those brushes here in my brushes panel. I will have to load those brushes, but I can do that now by coming here to the options button, and now I can say import brushes, which will take me to this folder again, and you can see I can now import any of the brushes that I have in this folder. Once I've done that, I recommend that you spend a bit of time exploring. I'm going to open up the drawing box folder, and I'm going to scroll down until I see one of my favorite brushes, this Kyle Drawing Box New Pastel. New Pastel is a brand of pastel many illustrators love to work with. Kyle Webster has worked very hard to get this brush to have the same look. New Pastel is a lovely and sensitive brush. What I love about it is that if I press lightly, you can see that just like a real pastel, if I scumble across the surface of my drawing, you can see I get very light coverage. If I press a little harder, you can see that I can fill in that texture. These brushes, as you can see, are very sensitive. I'm just going to press Command-Z a couple of times. Once I have a brush that I like, what I like to do is make a copy of it and then save it in a new folder. With the brush that I like selected, I'm going to come to the Brushes panel and select New Brush Preset. And I'm going to give this brush a new name. In fact, I'm going to give it my name, at least my initials. That way, anytime I see a brush with my initials, I know it's a brush that I've made. I'm going to say OK. You can see now I have a duplicate of that brush that I was just working with. But now I'm going to do something that is new to Photoshop 2020. I can now make a folder here in my Brushes panel by clicking on the folder icon and creating a new folder with my name or at least my initials on it. And I can now take this brush and drag it into this folder. In this way, I can create a folder of brushes that I particularly like. In fact, I've already done this. If I scroll up to the top, you can see I've got a number of brushes that I like to work with. I'll load these brushes so that you can download them. Now, in my exploration of these drawing box brushes, I discovered this brush here. And with a couple of modifications, it works fairly well to replicate the pencil crayon of the illustration. Let me show you what I mean. I'm going to select that brush, close that panel, and what I'd like to do is put a little bit of highlight in her hair. First of all, I'm going to choose a very light yellow color. I'm going to say OK. I'm going to create a new layer above this one, and I'm going to just start drawing onto the top of the head here. And as you can see, this brush has a lot of the texture of the underlying surface built into it. And as I mentioned, I'm just going to be drawing across the top of the head like that. If I'm not really happy with the way that texture of that brush works, I can come over here to my brush settings panel. I'm going to click on my texture option. I'm going to make the texture scale much smaller. Okay, let's see how that works. That works better. I like that. You can still see how it mimics the texture. I'm just going to work that brush into some of the areas where I might want to see some highlights. The other thing that I want to try to emulate is the watercolor, as you can see here in some of the background areas. For that, I'm going to open up my brushes panel, I'm going to close my mega pack, and I'm going to scroll down to my watercolor brushes. I like this one here, Kyle's Real Watercolor Round Robin. And I'm just going to work a little bit of the color to suggest a bit more texture into the road. I'm going to zoom out. A little bit more time probably would have yielded slightly better results. The last thing I'm going to do is come to the Layers panel. I'm going to create a new layer right above my background layer. And I'm going to set this layer to overlay. One of the things that Alyssa was trying to achieve here was a glow effect around our sun and moon. But unfortunately, that's a tough effect to achieve in traditional media. But we can do something with that here in Photoshop. With this new layer created, set to overlay, I'm going to use my render brush that I created in an earlier video. I'm going to come over here to my swatches panel, and I'm going to choose the bright yellow at the top of my color swatches. And on this layer, I'm going to paint over top of the sun. And you can see how that glow of the sun is now being painted in over top. Let's do the same thing with the moon. I'm going to come back to my swatches panel. This time I'm going to choose a cool color and I'm going to paint over this part of that same layer. Create that glowing moon effect. And there we go. We've been able to make some digital modifications while maintaining the illustration's traditional media quality. Let's just take a look at a couple of other illustrations here. Brenna's illustration here was done very well, but if we take a look at the original, you can see that the only real problem was a lack of color vibrancy for our main subject. You can see here that I've created a new levels adjustment layer to bring out the color that was already there. Otherwise, this is absolutely fabulous. Let's take a look at Kelsey's illustration. There's an interesting narrative being suggested here. All I did was create a levels adjustment and then a shadow layer with that purple-pink color set to multiply and then a light layer as orange set to overlay. And you can see these two colors in conjunction create an interesting light effect. For Jade's illustration, let me open up the layers panel. I love this illustration. There's so much character and color. Look at the color shift that Jade has achieved over the form of her characters. You can see that, again, I've created a new layer over top called Overlay. And then, using some brushes that I found in my Mega Pack, created some strokes and some outlines to help bring out some distinction between our main characters and the background. This is absolutely gorgeous. Julianne has done something quite interesting. You can see in its original state, it still looks great. My only suggestion was a slightly larger banner across the top. And here, I've created a soft vignette set to multiply that again helps bring focus around our main character. Flandre has created something very interesting. In its original state, it looked like this. My only issue was with the rather unnatural horizontal line that these trees made here. I used a liquefy effect from the filter drop-down menu, liquefy, to create a variation in that line. I've also added a color in a layer over top of the original layer set again to overlay. Nicely done. Megan's Rapunzel illustration is wonderfully composed. All I've done was create a new layer over top where I've painted in some shadows over top of the background. But I've also created a glow layer set again to overlay to help accentuate her amazing hair. Again, something I've done here again with Michaela's. If I open this up, you can see that there's nothing wrong with this. I've just added a little bit of glow and accentuated the shadow. Same thing for you, Rebecca. Love this illustration, by the way. For yours, Danny, all I did was create a little gradient in the background to help bring some distinction between your foreground and background characters. Let's take a look at Avery's illustration. This is a lovely illustration. There's really nothing we need to change. I'm going to open up the layers panel, though, and just show you what I've done here anyway. The first thing I've done is I've added a layer here. I'll turn that on. This layer has a color fill that I sampled from the background. I've set the layer to multiply and have applied a mask so that it reveals just this shadow over top of the eyes and a little bit of the shadow underneath the arm here. The only other thing that I did here is I made a selection around the wolf and then added an adjustment layer to give the wolf just a little bit more value range, just to help him stand out against that background just a little bit better. But I also wanted to help him stand out by shifting his color from warm to cool. Finally, I added a levels adjustment over top of everything just to increase the contrast and overall drama. Let's take a look at Aiden's. Aiden's done something very interesting here. I love the brush work. It seems very appropriate for the subject matter. Again, that watercolor brush is something that we can approximate. I'm going to open up my brushes panel. This is one of the brushes that came in the Mega Pack, but I've made some adjustments to it, changed its name. I'm going to zoom in here just so that I can show you how this works. I'm going to sample the dark purple color, and I'm just going to start brushing that in like so. I love the way this brush builds up tone slowly. You can also see that it's got a little bit of the effect of watercolor where it goes on and then dries a little bit lighter. I'm just going to paint into the shadow areas here. Again, this brush is responsive to pressure. This works with a pressure-sensitive tablet. Deepen some of the shadows here. Finally, with yours, Rio, this is a lovely painting. Let me zoom in to this just a little bit. I'm not sure what medium you're using. It looks like it could be gouache or acrylic. In either case, this is an opportunity to explore some of Photoshop's paintbrushes. Again, if I open up the Mega Pack, you'll notice that one of the folders is called Paintbox. If I twirl that down, I can scroll down to explore the Paintbox brushes. Some of them here, as you can see, are actually gouache brushes. I'm going to click on this one here, Gouache Wet, and I'm going to sample some of the darker orange here, and I can begin to work that into my painting. And you can see that this has the look and feel of the brushwork that Rio had already established. If I zoom out and open up this layer, the only thing that I felt that this image really needed was perhaps a little bit more color. Perhaps not as much as I've put in here. That would be my only recommendation. Anyway, I hope that has been helpful.